as the title already indicated, it is not the end of the project towards the construction of a questionnaire, but we have empirical data now, and these are from the two prior iterations, so that we would like to share our results and ideas with you. What is our general motivation behind this topic? It is to provide learning scenarios that are as adaptable as possible in relation to the software engineering learning contents and the students' needs for that. So the idea was to construct an instrument that extracts existing learning obstacles regarding to specific learning contents and to provide adaptable learning scenarios depending on the answers of the questions in an automatic way later on. So the purpose of this underlying study is to get ideas on how to extract learning obstacles and to verify our before set up learning dimensions. We are of the view that our students face many different learning obstacles to learning, and we would like to know what kind are they of, how can they be extracted or detected, and are they associated with specific learning contents. This leads me now to the following agenda. Since no classification of learning obstacles from students' perspectives exists, the first step was to set up possible learning dimensions of learning obstacles. And this is also what I will explain first and forms the theoretical background. Then I will report on the first two iterations we proceeded to verify our obstacle dimensions. So, first of all, we also recognized or set up a, where is he? An emotional learning obstacle dimension as well. This obstacle dimension is derived from the learning strategy that concerns motivational and emotional aspects, such as a family accident or a bad experience or bad grade in a subject. But we have another one. This is, or we call this the epistemological learning obstacle dimension, and this is derived from the cognitive load theory. Exactly the intrinsic load, and mostly found in literature. It describes a misjudgment of the learning object and our individual competencies related to it, such as a misconception or I've heard the learning content is difficult. Then we have the didactical learning obstacle dimension. This is also derived from the cognitive load theory, exactly the extraneous load. And it describes external interferences regarding structure, setting, and type of material for a course. An example here would be a deflection in an overcrowded room, for example. Then we have the resource-related learning obstacle dimension, which is again derived from a learning strategy classification and is concerning strategies for internal and external resources, such as effort and time management of a learner or the environment. Either this is unknown or these resources are not accessible or not available for the learner. The fifth dimension is a metacognitive learning obstacle dimension, and it is derived from learning strategies too. It concerns metacognitive strategies such as self-controlling. For example, a disability of planning the own learning steps. And last, we have a psychogenetic learning obstacle dimension. This is derived again from the cognitive load theory, exactly from the germane load, and this obstacle reduces the germane load. That, for example, a person with dyslexia. So, What about a definition for a learning obstacle? What is it? We defined it as follows. A learning obstacle can be at least assigned to one of the five dimensions, namely the emotional, epistemological, didactical, resource-related, and metacognitive, and represents an obstacle that prevents a learner in any manner from learning. As you recognize it, we excluded the psychogenetic obstacle, since we are not of a medical profession and are not interested in research on that. So what you can see here is our current general structure of our procedure. First of all, a pretest was done for getting an overview of existing difficulties from a student's perspective and to get an idea on how to define items that extract learning obstacle dimensions. Secondly, we conducted a survey using the Motivated Strategies for Learning questionnaire in order to verify the five learning obstacle dimensions we set up before. And both of these results were used to create a third questionnaire, so the resulting questionnaire for measuring learning obstacles in software engineering courses. And this will be newly developed and conducted. So the first iteration purpose. This was on getting ideas on how to verify the learning obstacle dimensions and getting ideas on how to extract the most difficult learning content and how to relate it to the learning obstacle dimensions. So hopefully this is readable. It was a kind of four-partite structure. First of all, we asked a question for getting ideas to the dimensions of learning obstacles. These were 9 items with a 5-point Likert scale and about 2 items per dimension. Secondly, there was the question about the difficult learning contents, and we asked them 2 times. First, they had to rank the given learning contents regarding difficulty, and then they had to choose the most difficult one for them. Afterwards, we asked the first question again, but this time in association with the difficult learning content. And lastly, we asked 2 open questions for getting new ideas, what we didn't consider the construction of the first questionnaire. We had 77 participants from 4 different locations in Bavaria, Germany, whereas 61 completed the answers. All students were software engineering students with fairly the same learning content. I say fairly the same learning content because, as my colleague before already indicates it, in Germany there is the law of freedom and research. In research and teaching, and therefore no standardized curriculum. The survey was proceeded within a semester evaluation, and all items were self-formulated. So, as already explained, there was 1 question where the participant had to rank each specific learning content, like process model, requirements engineering, review, configuration management, UML, design pattern, software test, and implementation, from big problems to low problems on a 5-point Likert scale. In a second step, we asked them to select the most difficult learning content with the same choices, and the results are corresponding. In the ranking question, implementation had the lowest mean, which stands for the biggest problems on the scale, and at the choice question, 62.2% of all students who participated at the course choice implementation as the most difficult one. Similar results came up to contents like design pattern. So this is the question where we want to get an idea about the learning obstacle dimensions. The students assessed statements referring to the course like, I have trouble to motivate myself, or the didactical design for the teaching impeded my learning, and these both statements were meanly rated as most true. The same 9 items were asked later again, but then the students had to refer their questions to the course content. They choose as most difficult one. Which means because most students chose implementation as most difficult, they assessed all statements with respect to the course content implementation, of course. In this question, there was a change in the students' answers, and the statement the complexity of the course content cramped for learning has the lowest mean with respect to implementation. Lessons learned for the first questionnaire, or for the first iteration. We had to improve the item formulation, and we had to ask more items per dimension. Just two items are not enough. In the end, we asked the two open questions in order to get more information of existing problems, and we asked for reasons for the learning content, like implementation to be the most difficult one, and mapped them to the dimensions. Answers like complexity of the topic, or missing or insufficient programming knowledge of the students, this would be mapped to the epistemological dimension. Answers like no interest can be mapped to the emotional or motivational dimension. Answers referring to the course design, for example, or the lecturer can be mapped to the didactical dimension. So, lessons learned. Again, more items on the questions where necessary. So, for those for whom the explanation was not now confusing, this is the structure of the first questionnaire. So, we have first the ideas about the obstacle dimensions, then the ranking, then the choice, and then again the learning obstacle dimensions. So the second iteration was based as a consequence of the first iteration on the motivated strategies for learning questionnaire as a, and the MSLQ are, the items of the MSLQ are going along with the aspect of the learning strategies mentioned above, for example, effort and time management as internal resources. Furthermore, we derived the obstacle dimensions from the same learning strategy classification as the MSLQ bases on, and therefore we decided to base on this questionnaire. The aim of this integration was to validate our five-dimensional model, and so we took all of the items and mapped them to our obstacle dimensions in order to evaluate the general possibility of taking this questionnaire, and the mapping was done in an iterator process, and all raters were familiar with the topic of the learning obstacles. So only one item could be applied to the didactical obstacle dimension, so that we have to generate new items for this factor. So we developed 12 new ones and expanded the questionnaire to 56 items. This questionnaire was preceded in Germany again and therefore translated to German. We use a 7-point Likert scale, as suggested by the MSLQ, and about 10 items could be assigned to each dimension. And we had a randomized order of the items, and this is also different to the first iteration. All in all, 420 students participated, and 272 completed the study. The results, the data was suitable for a factor analysis, and we were able to verify the five factor structure. And three of the five factors could unambiguously be mapped to the learning obstacle dimensions. These are the didactical factor, the emotional factor, and the metacognitive one. The epistemological and the resource-related dimensions were not as clearly assignable as the former factors were, and this is also true for the resource-related one. So we needed a review and modification, and all in all, we could say that 11 factors had no load, so that we could exclude them for the next iteration, and these are the three, one in bold, that could be approved. the psychogenetic one is crossed out, and the two others had to be reviewed. So thank you. I will skip the last results and
thank you, Rebecca,
open for questions. Yes.
Yes, just one question. If you have time for one question, no more than that, please. Okay, if there are no questions, you can discuss after that. Thank you, Rebecca, so much.